Good afternoon, everyone. we have been hearing in the last 2.5 days a variety of concepts, variety of methods to help persons on the spectrum and and a whole lot of interventions as well. And I'm sure, ideally speaking, we probably need to have people from different backgrounds who are doing different interventions to be all sitting on the panel here answering the question, but we'll try and get by with the three eminent professionals who are on the dais. I have here Dr. Steve Bhregrren. I got that right, Steve, yeah. He's spoken to you all yesterday. He works for the Center for Neurodevelopmental Disorders in the Karolinska Institute in Sweden. He has introduced us to the idea of software-based interventions, but also about how systematically to assess them, and not only look at those who, how and why people are responding, but also how and why people are not responding to interventions. Dr. Bhismadev Chakrabarti, professor of neuroscience from Reading University, UK, from Cal, and he has shared his exciting work about reward and mimicry and use of neuroscience in trying to understand autism. And we also have Professor Asoke, Saha, who's chairman and professor of psychology from Jagannath University, Bangladesh. I think while Dr. Bhishma is more working on the concepts related to understanding autism, and Steve here is actually looking at interventions and evaluations. Professor Saha has a much bigger job in terms of training and monitoring and probably even driving the all the forces needed to actually sensitize the community to autism and evaluate services. So we have people with three different types of backgrounds, and what I would do is the theme for today, it says opinions versus facts. I mean, you will all agree that when we come across a mystery, or when we come across something which we can't entirely feel absolutely satisfied with how much we can help or how much we can actually make a difference, there is a lot of rooms for myths, a lot of rooms for different opinions, and to cull out facts from all this and understand, it's one of the hardest jobs, and like we all talked over the last 2.5 days, it gets to be so hard for the families to make these decisions. So keeping this in this theme in background, I will start with Steve now. I'll ask him about, see, you did evaluate interventions, Steve. If you can share your views on how interventions need to be evaluated, interventions need to be, the rigor that goes into evaluating interventions before it can be made very widely available, and even then how to constantly monitor the progress of these evaluations. Your views on that?
I had my talk yesterday. I don't really remember what I said because I had really high fever. But I think it's really important when it comes to intervention that you really have to make sure that it actually works. And then you should do that on a group level. I mean, sometimes a lot of people talk about you do things one to one, and then you think that, okay, that really works for everybody. I think it's more important also to look into how you do these different trials. Like I was talking yesterday about social skills training, for instance, and that's a group activity. We actually had some kids getting worse from that because of some CNVs that anomalism that make the kid become worse. So I think it's really important that we really try this, and when you have a good, what you think is a good curriculum, you should try it on to many more people to see if it actually works. But even then, you can't be sure it's going to work for everybody. It's like a broad spectrum many times. In the other sense is also that if you actually measure this and you can see that we did the emotion training on the computer, we actually saw that, okay, the kids learn to recognize emotions much better and express them. But we don't have any evidence for it that it's used in a real life setting. So, I mean, even if you learn something that you learn in that environment, you have to look at the generalizability as well. Can we bring this outside to the real world? So even if you get better at recognizing emotions, it doesn't mean that you actually it's better recognizing emotions in a real life setting.
Thank you, Steve. So do you think manualizing and closely held regulated practice is an answer? I mean,
it's a part of an answer, I guess, sometimes. But I mean, also when you do research on interventions, and then you get it to a clinician sometimes, it's really a big drop in between there. Sometimes, especially, I know this from in Sweden anyhow, I don't know how it works here, but clinician takes ideas from, you know, an intervention program, but they don't follow the curriculum the same way the research was done. So you can't really be sure if you don't follow the curriculum and you know the training and who's doing the training, who's going to do the intervention, how the settings were and so forth. You're not following what the research actually showed. So it's really important from the research side as well to give out a curriculum that actually going to be used in the same sense.
Thank you, Steve. I see a question here for Dr. Bhismadev. I mean, I'll slightly rephrase it. It talks about how the application helped. I think the way I'm understanding this question is the kind of discriminations between children with autism and without that you demonstrated through your research work yesterday. I mean, there is, if you think you need to translate that as a tool for assessment in autism, I mean, what do you think would be the steps you need to take before you actually get there?
Right. So I demonstrated some data from brain imaging and psychophysiology studies showing group differences between autism, people with and without autism. And I also demonstrated some, I talked about some group differences that we are seeing with our app, which is for children 3 to 6 year old and to identify specific domains of function where there might be group differences. Now, just because group differences exist does not mean that they are ready to be used as a diagnostic tool. Because diagnosis is a very specialized and multi-stage process. And group differences will only tell you that, yes, on this specific assay, there is a difference in how the response is, whether it's physiology or brain activity. But even if it does show reliable group differences, it doesn't really mean that it discriminates between autism and, say, social communication disorder or autism and ADHD and or autism and ID. So I think that journey from, or that hope that we will have a brain-based test or a blood-based test that will help us pick out autism is a wild goose chase. And in the decade or more that I've worked on various aspects of brain imaging and genetics and psychophysiology, I have seen this enterprise grow with a lot of hope, and then the enthusiasm has now plateaued, that we really cannot get better than clinical diagnosis. So we need the human clinician to do a human judgment on the individual specific needs. And we have to own up to the fact that autism is not quite like cystic fibrosis, that you find the mutation and you get the diagnosis. So the translatability into a world where the clinician input is gone and only these brain imaging and psychophysiology measures will suffice, I don't think that world is not going to come.
Yeah, in that link, I mean, there's a question here saying, should clinicians keep in touch with genetic research at all?
I think definitely yes. Because there are specific genetic conditions that we know, the phenotype for those genetic conditions is much better defined, much better understood than what we call idiopathic autism or non-syndromic autism, where the exact genetic route is not known. Now, one direction that autism genetics is moving toward, and the jury is still out on this, is that, which is a little bit what has happened to cancer biology or cancer genetics, that if somebody says that I have cancer, doesn't really give you any information on which specific organ the cancerous tissue is in or which specific gene is affected in that person's cancer. Some specific genes are very well understood. Like for breast cancer, there is one gene called BRCA that's very well understood. So autism has begun, it has taken baby steps to that direction, that it is possibly a collection of a large number of rare variants, so small mutations that are very specific mutations that is associated with a huge impact. And in some of these cases where the mutations are well known, like Fragile X or Smith-Lemli-O'Pitt syndrome, the specific genes, you know the phenotype better and the management might be slightly more informed. But so the short answer is yes, they should keep in touch.
Keep in touch, yeah. So to summarize, I mean, there are some small and significant gains made which are important and we should all keep in touch with and understand. But to convert existing neuroscientific work into diagnosable kind of assays, I mean, it's some distance away. Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Dr. Bhishma. There's a very specific question for you, Dr. Ashok Saha. It says, what should be the priorities for research in your country? I mean, it specifies actually about your place. Or what do you think should be the priorities for research in autism area in your country?
Thank you very much. It's a very good question, actually. I sometimes, as a researcher, as a social psychologist, I used to think how we can overcome and how where I, as a social scientist, can contribute in autism research. I have seen in last 2 days there are a lot of clinical and special education purpose to solve and regarding diagnosis and occupational therapy and all that. But being a social psychology, I think there is a lot of things to do by us, that is caregiving and follow-up study, helping attitude, mental health of autistic children as well as mental health with autistic parents, and attitudes of the people in general, as well as the significant people's attitudes towards the autistic child as well as their families as well. And awareness of the general people as well as family support and social support is also very important aspects that we can address, and we are very much concerned about these issues because mental health is somehow or others related to our well-being. So for normal healthy life and in social life, in family life, we need support from our significant people and people of the society in general. So we have a lot of things to do in research on this to overcome the autism.
Thank you, Dr. Saha. I'll come back to Steve now. I mean, we hear a plethora of interventions. You spoke about how rigorously they need to be assayed. I mean, what do you feel about because the theme is about facts and opinions. I mean, what do you feel about interventions being considered like, you know, they are absolutely mandatory, that's the only way to go, and these kind of opinions abound in the area. What do you feel about that, and what would you insist that families should ask of professionals before accepting interventions?
It's a good question. First of all, if somebody says this is the only way, I should not listen, because there aren't any only ways when you work with kids with autism. I think it's really important also that before you get some intervention to the kids, you really have to assess the need for this kind of intervention before you do it. You really have to single out the ones that specific needs for this kid. So you can't go there and say like, okay, this is the only one, let's go with this. That doesn't work.
So you would think that the family should not be accepting generic interventions, even though the therapist might be an expert in that area. They need to check out how it matches with the needs of the child. I mean, because I'm really trying to see how to get a lot of family members here to get a sense of how to ask questions around the interventions and ask for evidence. So.
Yeah, that's a hard question also. Of course, when you're seeking your family, you're seeking help. Of course, you want to trust the professional, of course. But you can't really expect parents to know about different kinds of intervention and all these things. But I think you can always ask questions. Why do you think my kid needs this? And what should it help him? And so forth. Okay. More in that sense. I mean, not believe in like healing, that okay. That should work, actually.
Okay. Thank you. I would like to continue with this question for both the other panelists, and then I'll come back to specific questions. There's like, for example, you spoke about the need to understand genetic research, but it's still in its infancy. Now, but we hear a lot about, you know, stem cell and variety of interventions, which are actually very expensive and not really tested. So what's your take on how these interventions, what should be the perspective that families need to have around these kind of interventions?
Thank you for this question, because this is something that's extremely serious. Because in fora like this, and I've been in various fora like this across the world, where there are parents who are looking for a solution, and there are people who are selling products. It is possibly a pharmacological product, or a stem cell therapy product, or some specific type of intervention product. First thing is, when we are listening to any one of us speakers, we have a responsibility, and whoever is organizing such future meetings will have the responsibility to ask for conflicts of interest. Because it's very essential, if I have built stem cell therapy, and I'll talk about stem cell therapy briefly in a moment, a solution, and if I tell you that, oh, I tested 10 autistic children and all of them are doing really well now, that doesn't count, because I am effectively asking for money from you to invest in stem cell therapy so that I can make a living out of it. So I think that conflict of interest statement practice is essential in meetings like these. And I particularly pick out stem cell therapy because I've had questions from parents and practitioners yesterday outside the talk, and there is absolutely no evidence whatsoever in favor of stem cell therapy working. There is no understanding of mechanism. There is, the stuff that gets sold on websites and stuff say that you inject stem cells and they can travel to the brain and repair parts that are not working well. I mean, that is against all knowledge and understanding of the brain. So there is, and that can cause harm. Effectively, that can cause harm. So be very careful. Be very, very careful. And you asked me about what questions should parents ask. My suggestion is, the first thing is, has there been a randomized clinical trial, control trial that, of this particular intervention, where it has been compared against either treatment as usual or another treatment, something like that, and something that's ideally done by a non-biased and unbiased person rather than the person who is selling the intervention. So the onus is on the person selling, not on you to believe. The onus is on them to provide the evidence.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Bhishma. Thank you. Your take, Professor Saha, on various interventions that are available, I mean, what would be your suggestion to families, if, for example, in your own country or in any other families in developing countries, hearing about a variety of interventions across the internet today, and when they ask about, you know, how would you guide your families, or what kind of research you feel is necessary to ensure that more of an evidence-based intervention is delivered, for example, in your country?
Thank you. Yes, in Bangladesh nowadays, there are at least 10 medical colleges and hospitals where the autism's corners are there, and there is a lot of specialized people working over there. So there is a OPD, regular OPD, so one can go there, and to after diagnosis they can take help, occupational therapy from CRP, which is also located in Dhaka, and also near Dhaka there is another center, and they have their long run experience to handle with autistic patient as well as their parents. And also there are child development center in every medical colleges, financed by JICA Japan and other donor agencies as well. So once the child is diagnosed as autistic, so they should go there. And there is another information I'm giving you, that there are lot of schools, a specialized school called Prayash, is run by the military of Bangladesh. So they have their good facilities over there, but all are not residential. But only daycare systems are there, so they should go there for their education and other support.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Sir. What I get from your statement is, if you find interventions that are being practiced in formal and approved settings, they are probably more likely to be something that's got evidence base, and you would direct families to go to those kind of places and seek intervention. Thank you very much. Here's a question for Steve here. It says, do you think there's a marked usage of neurofeedback for treatment of various aspects in autism? What's your view?
Actually, we are running a big clinical trial on neurofeedback at our center. It's not finished yet. We included about 250 kids, mainly with ADHD, but both with comorbidity with AST. So there are mixed results and mixed in this field. So I don't really have a good answer. I'm waiting to see what the results are from our from our trial.
So the theme of opinions and facts, what you're saying is, to say certain neurofeedback therapies are clearly working, the jury is still out there, and one is waiting for clear evidence to declare so.
I mean, you should be really cautious about neurofeedback, because there are many different types of neurofeedback, and some of them are really bad for you. We know that. So like we were saying here before, you should really go to a center where it's actually controlled and so forth if you're going to do it. You wouldn't go out on the internet and take the first one you see. So it's really important that you really find out, is this not a dangerous neurofeedback?
In all your answers, Steve, one important theme that's come through, and I would highlight, flag that out here, is, I mean, don't expect side effects only from medications. I mean, there are challenges coming from non-pharmacological interventions, which can also carry risks, and it's good to be informed about these things.
Yeah, it's all money seekers, like Bhishma said here. I mean, people want to make money sometimes. And one good thing is that if it sounds too good to be true, it's probably not true.
Not true. Thank you, Steve. That's something to carry home. Bhishma, there's a specific question here for you, a couple of them, but I'll probably, keeping time in mind, I'll ask one of this. How do we include, or how do we not include, or how can we include ASD plus intellectual disabled children? Because most studies seem to only involve children with high functioning autism. And of course, and the related question is, what are the pros of making children with autism comfortable in EEG and fMRI setups?
Thank you. So this specific question, I have actually written an article on exactly this specific question, on the need to include children with ASD and ID, comorbid ID, in research. Because a lot of research, especially brain and behavior research, just for our convenience as researchers, we just deal with the higher functioning, higher ability group. But the challenges, of course, for including the ID comorbid group, is that as the challenges for us to design tasks that are appropriate. Now, some tasks where we cannot expect very highly complex tasks, and we cannot expect often we cannot expect somebody to sit very still and do the task. So any techniques that require you to sit still, like EEG or eye tracking, or the high resolution data comes in there, those are kind of out of the way. So we have to think of assays that can stand some kind of movement. So thinking about wearables. So we have been thinking about wearables and also virtual reality goggles, which people can wear, and we can record from, say, electrodes that are strapped onto the hands. Now, that also has its own challenges, because what we found was the electrodes that are like watches that we strap onto the hands, they sometimes can cause sensory discomfort. So the individuals would like to take them off. So it is immensely challenging. Brain imaging-wise, it's one approach, a kind of a blunt approach, has been that wait till they fall asleep and then wheel them into the scanner and then collect resting state fMRI at sleep or resting state EEG. But that's kind of, that's the shortcut, and that's the bare minimum we can do.
Thank you. Thank you, Bhishma. Dr. Saha, I'll ask you a question from my... I mean, if you need to say one new thing that you would insist that your students should start learning, thinking about, and working towards, what would that be? And
in our department, actually, we have our undergraduate and postgraduate courses in psychology, and postgraduate course, master's in educational and developmental psychology, and master's in clinical psychology. Clinical and counseling psychology, and there is another department of industrial and organizational psychology. And first of all, as far as research is concerned regarding any applied issue, I always try to suggest my student to take any challenges. What are the challenges in our society and relating to our psychology?
So you would
and
be
to conduct some of the pilot study,
challenges.
Pilot study first, if and then take some intervention plan if it is works. Then we can go for larger study, because larger study involve a lot of cost and expenses. Yeah. So this is my suggestions for students, those who wants to come forward for research in psychology. Yeah.
Thank you, Dr. Saha. There's one question for Dr. Bhishma, and then we'll have a quick summarizing round. We got 2 minutes to go. What three specific things around neuroscience you would think parents need to be informed about as it stands today?
That's very hard. So I think the one, I would talk about principles. So the first principle that needs to be kept in mind is that the first 1,000 days of life are the most important for brain development. So, and that's when the brain is plastic. So this is the principle of plasticity and development is possibly the most crucial thing. And do remember that behavior or behavioral interventions can shape the brain. You don't necessarily need to stimulate it with an electrode or plug stem cells into it to change the brain. If we behave in a certain way, if we form habits, then changes are happening in the brain. So in those first 1,000 days of life, the principle of plasticity is the most crucial one, and also remembering that autism is possibly, most likely, a disorder of neural connectivity. So different areas of the brain are possibly not firing as synchronously as they should. So people with autism might get to the point, but it might take a little longer. So, because right. the connections are possibly happening. Not always working at the speed they would
okay.
otherwise.
Okay. Thank you. First 1,000 days, neuroscience would emphasize, and there has to be a lot of work, and parents need to understand the extraordinary things happening in the first 1,000 days in the brain. Yeah. As we come to the end, we've got about 30 seconds left. Any take on this theme of opinions versus facts? I'll go from Steve to Dr. Saha in that direction. Probably take a minute longer, organize this.
What was the question?
Any last, any word you would like to share finally with the audience on themes of facts versus opinions in the field of autism?
I think it's a fact that we should work together more. I mean, the Western world with India and so forth, and we should try to develop different things in different other cultures and see if we can work together so we can get good intervention programs all over the world.
Thank you.
I think my take home would be do not trust until you have seen the evidence. Just because somebody is saying that it works in my 10 children with autism does not mean that it will work for your child.
Thank you.
As for research, please do some experimental research on very small number of samples, but it should be scientifically appropriate. And there must be some experimental group and control group and give some interventions. And the analysis of the result, if you found very significant results, then you go for the intervention.
Thank you very much. I'll just summarize by saying researchers are sounding very cautious, and they're saying one way, try to get interventions systematically evaluated, try to work with larger and larger groups, connect across countries globally to see if an intervention is working, and be very cautious when you claim that an intervention is actually working. Thank you. Thank you so much.